falls. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great.
Good Friday service. If you've ever joined us before for a Good Friday service, you're going to know that it's going to look quite a lot different this year. For obvious reasons, we can't go on a journey around church and the buildings like we would do usually. So instead, I'm going to need everybody to use their imaginations as we go through some videos that explore the story of what happened on Good Friday just under 2,000 years ago. So today, along with Maundy Thursday and Easter Eve, are generally regarded as the three most solemn days of the year by Christians. These are the three days on which we hinge the whole meaning of life and the purpose of the universe. It's Good Friday, God's special day, which he'd planned from the very beginning as the only way to heal and mend the mess we've made of this world. We're going to walk with Jesus through his last few hours, from Maundy Thursday through to all the way to the cross. As we go, there'll be some bits to do, some readings. As you saw in the worship at the beginning, you might want to find some bread and maybe a drink to share with everybody who's watching, and maybe a couple of twigs and a bit of string or a pipe cleaner or something like that. And I'll explain what we're going to do with those later on. If you don't have them, doesn't matter, you can always do it after the service. So today, Good Friday, is the day that death died. It's the death of death, and that's the story we're going to find. We're going to start our journey with a prayer. Father, we have come together as a family of God to remember the day that Jesus chose to die for us, to try to understand what it must have been like for Jesus to tread the path to the cross and to wonder just how much he loved us. Amen. So let's set the scene for our first video. It's Thursday night, it's later in the evening, and for Jesus and his 12 disciples, it's time for their Passover meal. We're in an upstairs room around a low table, lit by candles, and the guests are reclining on couches. They had celebrated a meal like this probably every single year of their lives, and at least twice with Jesus himself. But tonight in Jerusalem of this year, of this week, it felt different. Let's watch the story. It was nearly time to begin the festival meal. This should have been a time of joy and celebration, but already Jesus knew that his enemies were close at hand and that their plan was to kill him. He was very sad. While they were sitting down to eat, Jesus said, "You have been my close companions and followers, but already I know that one of you is going to betray me." They were shocked and began to protest loudly. "Surely it is not me," said one. "I would never do that," exclaimed another. "Impossible." And they all denied that they would ever do such a thing. Jesus did not argue, nor did he change his mind. So they continued the meal. It was a Passover after all, a time to remember the story behind the festival. The story told of a time, 1,000 years earlier, when God had rescued them from slavery in Egypt and led them to a land they could make their home. God had made a covenant with the nation, a special promise to be their God and for them to be God's people. They were following the old traditions when Jesus did something different. He took a piece of bread and broke it and gave it to his companions. "Take and eat it," he said. "This is my body." Then he took the cup of wine and gave thanks to God. "Drink this, all of you," he said. "This is my blood. It is the seal of God's new covenant, the sign that you can trust in God's new promise. My blood is going to be poured out for the forgiveness of sins. I will never again drink this wine until the day I drink the new wine with you in my Father's kingdom." What he said was puzzling, disturbing even. But then Jesus often said things that left them wondering what to make of it all. So they let it pass. After the meal, they sang a hymn and they went out into the night. Wait, where's Judas? He's disappeared.
So in the Passover story, death had passed over the Israelites in slavery because of the blood on the doorposts. Death again would pass over them once more because of Jesus's death on a wooden post. Jesus is broken like the bread, so that in the end, death will not be able to break us. He must die so that we can live. They shared the bread together in this meal. If you've got some bread and maybe a drink, why don't you share it now with your families? Let's move on to the next part of the story. So now I need you to imagine it's midnight, very late, it's dark. For Jesus and his 12, although now 11 because we've lost Judas, disciples, they've gone to a garden of olive trees. It's called Gethsemane. It was one of their favourite places. It's a place where they went to rest, a place they went to get away from the crowd, to pray, and to be peaceful. They were very tired. Let's find out what happened when they got to the garden.
"I am only going to be with you a little longer," Jesus said. He turned to Peter, James, and John. "My heart feels so heavy. I am so unhappy. Please stay with me and pray." Then Jesus went just a little way from them and fell to the ground. He knew that the time was coming when he would be taken away from his friends, and worse still, from his Father in heaven. He knew that he would die a horrible death. "Please, Father," he prayed, "if there is another way, don't let this happen to me. But it's not what I want that is important. I will do what you want." While he was praying, his friends had fallen asleep. He woke them up and said, "Please stay awake to watch and pray. I need your help. I really do." Three times Jesus returned. Three times he found his friends asleep. Suddenly came a blaze of light, lanterns, torches, the sound of iron weapons. Judas came and greeted Jesus with a kiss. Behind him were armed men. Jesus remained calm. He did not fight. He let the soldiers take him away. His companions ran away in terror.
Most of us, at some time or another, have been let down by a friend. Can you imagine how Jesus felt? He was really struggling to keep on going because God wanted him to do something that was really hard. He wanted him to die. And then what did his friends do? They kept letting him down, not just once, but over and over. They fell asleep when he wanted them to pray and watch with him. His greedy friend Judas lets him down and gets him arrested. And then later in the story, Peter, his loyal friend, pretends that he doesn't even know Jesus. Not once, not twice, but three times. Jesus knew all about being let down. Sometimes we let God down over and over by not living the way that he wants us to. And just as Jesus' heart was heavy and breaking in that midnight garden, so God's heart breaks for us. He loves us so much that he sent his son Jesus. We're going to spend some time now saying our confession. A confession means that we're saying sorry to God for all the things that we've done wrong. We call these sin. And as we say the words of the confession, we can imagine these things being taken away from our heart. When I say, "Lord, forgive us," you can join in and say, "Christ, have mercy." You can say it out loud, or you can just say it in your heads if you prefer. Lord Jesus Christ, we confess we have failed you just as your first disciples failed you. We ask for your mercy and your help. When we rest rather than watch with you, Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. When we give a kiss of peace but have hatred in our hearts, Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. When we strike at those who hurt us, rather than stretch out our hands to bless, Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. When we deny that we know you for fear of the world and its scorn, Lord, forgive us. Christ, have mercy. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his love forever. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Wrong things that we've done, knowing that because Jesus kept going, even when it was hard and when his friends let him down, we are forgiven and those wrong things have been listed. Let's carry on with the next part of our story. We're moving into a crowded courtroom. It's early morning and Jesus has been awake all night, moved from one place to the next. He's been tied up, he's bruised, he's battered, he's bedraggled. The high priest looked for charges in order to get the death sentence passed. But all that had been heard was a confusion of lies and tales. Finally, Jesus is taken to the Roman governor, Pilate, because only he can give permission for a crucifixion. Let's see what happens.
Pilate had little interest in Jesus. There were plenty of young men in this province keen to lead their people to freedom. Jesus was like them, only he wasn't a fighter. "Are you the king of the Jews, as your enemies claim you say you are?" he inquired. Jesus replied, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If it did, my followers would fight to keep me safe from my enemies. No, I was born and came into the world for one purpose, to speak about the truth. Whoever belongs to the truth listens to me." Pilate wanted to set Jesus free, but how could he do so and still please the people? It was the custom at this festival time for him to set a prisoner free, so he decided to appeal to the crowds. From a high platform of his palace, he spoke to the people. "Do you want me to set free for you the King of the Jews?" he called. A few days earlier, the crowds had welcomed Jesus, but Jesus' enemies had been hard at work. "Crucify him! Crucify him!" came the clamour. Pilate saw that his plan had failed, and now he feared a riot. Washing his hands of the case, he let Jesus' own people have their way.
This was the place of judgment. Here Jesus was condemned. Here they made a pretend king out of the real king. Jesus took all the anger, the accusations and curses that the whole human race had ever heaped upon God, and he accepted them. He agreed to be the solution to our problems, the sin, the mistakes and the mess of our world. We're going to spend some time reflecting and listening to a song. While we do that, it's time for your twigs and your sticks to shine if you've got them. And the beauty of a video is if you haven't got them and you want to join in, you can pause me whilst you go and grab some. So if you take your sticks, your twigs, whatever they want, and wrap your string around, you can use any colour. I'm using purple because that's what I had. And form a cross. After the song's finished, we're going to move on with the rest of our story.
The wrath of God was satisfied.
Pilate's soldiers twisted together a crown of sharp thorns and jammed it on Jesus' head. "Look, everyone, it's King Jesus," they laughed. They placed a heavy wooden cross on his back and made him carry it to a place outside of the city.
To follow Jesus on the final part of his journey. It was 9 o'clock in the morning. Jesus had been whipped to within an inch of his life. He had staggered with the cross beams as far as he was able. He'd been nailed to the wood and hung up to die. Let's listen to the final part of our story.
Roman soldiers did the terrible work of crucifixion. They nailed living flesh to rough wood and hoisted the cross up on a hillside for all to see. Jesus was in anguish. He was dying. It seemed like his life's work had failed. He cried aloud two lines from a psalm he had learned when he was a boy. My God, why have you forsaken me?" No help came. The sky grew dark. The hours wore on. Jesus saw his mother standing with his friend John, and he called to them, asking the young man to take care of the old sorrowing Mary. He looked down at all the people, his triumphant enemies, his frightened, weeping friends. And he said a prayer to God. "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they are doing." Suddenly, all was still. "It is finished," Jesus cried out. And at that moment that Jesus died, the earth trembled.
So what's going on? This isn't the way that heroes usually conquer their enemies. This kind of looks like a defeat, not a victory. A little bit like losing, not winning. Or is it? Only by beating death at its own game could Jesus win. Only by taking all that death could throw at him and not becoming as bad as death himself could Jesus overcome death. Only by absorbing death's poison could he create the antidote to death that he could share with us all. He did this all for us. Our world is hurting in so many ways, at the moment more so than ever. And Jesus has shown how much God cares for us, how much pain he will take for us. We're going to spend a little bit of time now praying for our hurting world. There'll be a little bit of music playing while we do. And we're going to work through the TSP model of prayer. So thank you, sorry, please. There'll be some guidance on the screen as we go through it. Perhaps also while we listen to the music and think of our prayers, we could reflect that Jesus came for all, no matter what we're like, no matter how different we are from the next person. Let's pray.
Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice, you became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life, I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again.
To finish our time together with a prayer brought to you by the children, some of the children of this church, before handing over to Jonathan for the blessing.
Red is for the blood he gave.
Green is for the grass he made. Yellow is for the sun so bright.
Orange is for the edge of night.
Black is for the sins we made.
White is for the good.
Purple!
And purple is our sorrow.
Pink is for our future mother.
Amen!
On this Good Friday, may we be aware of the God who gave his all for us, holding us and drawing us ever closer in love to him and one another. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and always. Amen. A huge thank you to those who have drawn this service together for us, and especially the children who have given us some deep joy in this time. A reminder that we will gather again at 2 o'clock for a service of reflection, and then 8 o'clock for a quiet reflection this evening. And then again on Sunday as we gather to celebrate Easter. A huge blessing to you all, and may you stay well and keep safe.